What's up, everybody? In today's video, we are going to be talking about an extremely difficult but yet so high yield topic, and this is going to be on HIV medications. Before I get into today's video, please remember that if you like my channel, you enjoy my content, and you want to support my mission to provide free medical education, please consider clicking the join button. You can find this join button underneath every video on my channel homepage and is the first link in the description of every video. By clicking this button, you will sign up to become a Dirty Medicine member, which means you will send $4.99 to me in support of my channel, which of course is done through YouTube, which is owned by Google, so it's obviously quite secure. And in exchange for that financial support of my channel, you will be a Dirty Medicine member. Now, what that means is that you'll be able to comment anywhere on my videos or on my channel, and the Dirty Medicine logo will appear after your name. So people will see your username on YouTube and be like, whoa, that person's a Dirty Medicine member. That person supports free medical education. You'll also get access to the locked section of my community tab. So on the community tab, I'm making members-only posts, where you can vote on the topic of my next video and engage in conversation that just general subscribers cannot. So if you like my channel and want to give back financially, please consider signing up to be a Dirty Medicine member. Now let's get into today's video. These are the topics of medications that we are going to go through. So we'll start with the NRTIs, which are known as the nucleoside/nucleotide reverse transcriptase inhibitors. Then we'll talk about the NNRTIs. Those are the non-nucleoside/nucleotide reverse transcriptase inhibitors. We will touch briefly on the protease inhibitors as well as the integrase inhibitors and fusion inhibitors. Now, before I begin, I want to say that I fully understand and remember what it felt like when I was back in medical school learning this topic. This topic stinks. It's a ton of information. It's extremely hard to keep straight in your brain because there's a ton of different medication names. There's some with very unique side effects. The mechanisms are unique and they all sound alike, and there's no great mnemonics. If you've looked on the internet, the mnemonics for these medications stink. It's all clickbait crap. None of it's good. There's no resource that can teach you this well, in my opinion. So my goal today is to simplify this topic and package it into an easily understandable and easily digestible video so that you can study this in just a few minutes in my video and feel good about answering at least 90% of your questions correctly on USMLE or COMLEX. So we'll go through these categories one at a time. I'll give you the background. I'll talk about the mechanism, the side effects, all the stuff that you need to know physiologically, and then I'll throw in my mnemonics where appropriate so that by the end of this video, you will be a master of HIV therapy. So if we're going to start with the NRTIs, really the place to begin is talking about the mechanism, because we all know that NRTI, we all know what that stands for, but do any of us really understand what that means? So as a reminder, we need to talk about what reverse transcriptase does relevant to HIV. So recall that reverse transcriptase comes along and it finds HIV RNA. And then what it does, and basically how HIV ultimately integrates itself into the host genome, is that that HIV RNA is basically being used as a template on which the DNA primer will be made. So you've got these nucleotides that are hanging out, and obviously I'm simplifying on this slide, but just assume for the purpose of digesting this information that the black nucleotides will bind to the pink colored box and the orange nucleotides will bind to the green colored box. And as those nucleotides come along and get put onto the primer strand, you get the growth of ultimately this HIV double-stranded DNA. And once this is built, that double-stranded DNA will integrate into the host genome, and now all of a sudden HIV has unlocked the key to the host genome. Okay, so if we go back to this slide and we look at reverse transcriptase and the role that it plays, what an NRTI does is it gets, the person takes the medication, and all of a sudden in this pool of nucleotides, you've got this NRTI. And that NRTI will take the place of one of the nucleotides or one of the nucleosides, and it will put itself on that primer strand. Now, when that happens, the NRTI blocks the continued formation of that primer strand. So you never form the HIV double-stranded DNA. Effectively, the NRTI is turning off reverse transcriptase because it's preventing it from doing its job. Now, we'll talk about this more extensively on the next slide, but the reason that the NRTI is able to completely halt this process is because the NRTI is chemically unique, okay? So while it does have a nucleoside or nucleotide base, it does not have a 3-hydroxyl group. So when it gets put on the primer, it prevents the formation of that necessary 3,5-phosphodiester bond in the growing HIV DNA chain. So it basically gets put in and it lacks the chemical composition necessary to bind to the HIV RNA and grow that double-stranded chain. So when the NRTI finds its way into the primer strand, basically infiltrating into the reverse transcriptase, it completely inhibits this process. So that's how NRTIs work. And this is just sort of a more formal, typed out description of that mechanism. So you probably knew, again, coming into this video and coming into this discussion, what NRTI stood for. But if you didn't actually understand how NRTIs inhibited reverse transcriptase, you're definitely not going to get all your questions correct on USMLE, COMLEX, or in-class exams. It's very important you understand that it lacks the 3-hydroxyl group, and because of that, it prevents the formation of the 3,5-phosphodiester bond in the growing chain. The other unique aspect that's not as high yield, but you should know it, is that the NRTIs can inhibit the formation of either the positive or negative strand of the DNA in this process. So very, very unique. Okay, so takeaways so far, NRTIs. You know that RTI stands for reverse transcriptase inhibitor. Know that it inhibits reverse transcriptase because it lacks 3' hydroxyl group, therefore infiltrating its way in and preventing the 3,5-phosphodiester bond. Everything I just said is incredibly high yield and you need to know it. Now let's talk about side effects. So the big ones are peripheral neuropathy, bone marrow suppression, lactic acidosis, and then specific to two of our different NRTIs, you have pancreatitis for one of them and anemia for the other. Now, anytime, it should be a little bit intuitive for you to recognize peripheral neuropathy and bone marrow suppression, because anytime you're inhibiting a DNA process, you're going to get bone marrow suppression. Likewise, anytime you're inhibiting a DNA process, you usually, but not always, get peripheral neuropathy. Now, something that's pretty high yield for exams is to know that for the bone marrow suppression specifically, you treat that with GCSF, which stands for granulocyte colony stimulating factor. So if you're taking USMLE or COMLEX, you get a question where maybe they suggest to you, without telling you explicitly, but they suggest that the patient has HIV, and the way that they'll do that is they could give you either an AIDS-defining illness or describe the patient as sick, maybe give you a lab printout, and you have to recognize that it's likely, based on the information and the question, that the patient has HIV or AIDS. And then they tell you that the patient begins treatment, and then all of a sudden, patient has X, Y, and Z. And that X, Y, and Z will be bone marrow suppression. Which of the following is the most appropriate treatment? And you're going to want to pick granulocyte colony stimulating factor, also known as GCSF. So you can see I'm kind of illustrating to you here a perfect practice question. This is third order thinking. You have to pick up that the patient likely has HIV or AIDS. Then you need to know that the treatment caused bone marrow suppression. Then you need to know what the bone marrow suppression looks like clinically in the vignette, and then know what the treatment is. So that's really like a fourth order question. That's as challenging as they could go when it comes to HIV therapy. But those are the ways that you want to start to train your brain to think when it comes to this topic. Now, I know that what you guys are thinking. You're out there right now. You are listening to me teach this information. And so far, you're with me. But you're looking at the bottom of this slide and you're going, oh my God, Dirty, how am I ever going to remember pancreatitis with didanazine? How am I ever going to remember anemia with zidovudine? Like, I understand that that is the biggest anxiety when it comes to this topic. It's the specific side effect with the specific drug. So I'm speaking on behalf of medical students and other health professionals when I acknowledge that that is where most people feel uncomfortable in this topic. So my mnemonics are going to help you memorize this in the simplest way possible. So when it comes to pancreatitis is caused specifically by the NRTI didanosine. So instead of saying pancreatitis, you want to say pancreatitis, if you will. And the DID stands for didanosine, okay? So on the exam, you're going to be taking it. They're going to describe a patient with HIV to you. Then all of a sudden, they're going to say patient starts to have the following effects. And then the question is going to completely change course and start to describe pancreatitis. You're going to see pancreatic enzyme labs. you're going to see the classic buzzword symptoms of pancreatitis, and they're going to ask you which of the following medications is responsible for this presentation. And the answer is going to be didanosine. So you want to remember pancreatitis for pancreatidanosine. Okay. For anemia, anemia is specific to zidovudine. And the way that I remember this is I say the sentence that zidovudine gets zid of the hemoglobin, or gets rid, if you will, of the hemoglobin. So on your exam, on USMLE, COMLEX, or your in-class exam, they're going to give you a patient with very likely HIV/AIDS. Maybe they tell you that, maybe they describe it, it doesn't matter. But then, patient has the following symptoms: fatigue, blah, 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 and they give you the labs, and all of a sudden you see hemoglobin that is low. Which of the following medications is likely the cause of this presentation? The answer is zidovudine, because it got zid, or rid, of the hemoglobin. So train your brain to recognize these patterns, because this information is the basis for those challenging third plus order questions. Now let's look at a list of the NRTIs. So this list is all of the different NRTIs. Tenofovir is the only one that's a nucleotide. All the other ones are the base nucleoside. And that doesn't matter. It's not high yield at all, but I'm just pointing it out for completeness sake. So we've got abacavir, didanosine, emtricitabine, lamivudine, stavudine, tenofovir, and zidovudine. These are all the NRTIs. And if you're sitting there looking at this slide and you're like, oh my God, how am I going to know that these are the NRTIs? Calm down. Take a deep breath. We're going to get through this and it's going to be just fine. We're actually going to use the process of elimination to know that this list is the NRTIs. And this will make a lot more sense once we go through the protease inhibitors and the integrase inhibitors, because most of those drugs end with the same suffix or the same phrasing of the word. And again, you'll understand more when we get there, but we're going to use the process of elimination to know that everything that's not a protease inhibitor, everything that's not an integrase inhibitor, everything that's not an NNRTI must therefore be an NRTI. And again, once we go through the remaining groups of medications in this video, you'll know exactly what I mean. So take a deep breath. Don't get overwhelmed yet, because this will make a lot more sense. But this is your list of NRTIs. So with all of that information in mind, let's talk about the NNRTIs. And these are obviously very closely related to the NRTIs. So the non-nucleoside or non-nucleotide reverse transcriptase inhibitors basically do the same thing as the NRTIs. The only difference is that they bind to a different site at reverse transcriptase and create this hydrophobic pocket, which basically just slows down the synthesis of DNA overall, because that pocket basically makes a new configuration of the substrate binding site, and that alters the activity of these enzymes. That's not really high yield to know, but I point that out for completeness sake, because most people just have a textbook or a lecture in their class that says NNRTIs do the same exact thing as the NRTIs, but they bind at a different site, which is technically true, but it's not the complete picture. So it creates a hydrophobic pocket and it slows DNA synthesis. What I do think is pretty important to know is that the NNRTIs do not require phosphorylation to be active. So I didn't discuss this yet because I wanted to have the discussion here. But back when we talked about the NRTIs, what makes those different than the NNRTIs is that the NNRTIs don't need to be phosphorylated. So basically, the NRTIs, which again, we've already talked about, must be taken as prodrugs. And in that prodrug form, they get taken up into the host cell and phosphorylated. And if that doesn't happen, if that phosphorylation doesn't happen, they can't do their active job. The NNRTIs don't need to be phosphorylated. So that's unique to the NNRTIs. The other thing about the NNRTIs that is not high yield, but I will include here for completeness sake, is that NNRTIs are not effective against HIV-2 reverse transcriptase. And that's because NNRTIs are non-competitive inhibitors. So let's talk about adverse effects. NNRTIs, for most all of them, and there's three, we'll talk about the three individual drugs in just a second, it causes hepatotoxicity and a rash. Now, specific to the drug efavirenz, you get vivid dreams, and then both efavirenz and deliviridine are contraindicated in pregnancy. Now, obviously, the question becomes, what do I need to know? So what you need to know is hepatotoxicity and skin rash, but the most high-yield bit of information on this slide are that vivid dreams occur in efavirenz, because for whatever reason, these dang test writers just love the unique side effects. So again, I know that you're starting to hyperventilate, and you're like, how am I going to learn this? Calm down. So my mnemonic to remember this is, instead of saying efavirenz, I say efavivids. Efavivids. It almost sounds exactly the same. I can barely pronounce efavirenz as it is. But efavivids reminds me of vivid dreams. So on USMLE, on COMLEX, on in-class exams, let's say they give you a question, describe a patient with HIV/AIDS. They let you know that the patient is undergoing active treatment, and then all of a sudden they have this crazy dream. Which of the following is responsible for mediating the effect discussed in this presentation? They'll give you some drugs. Maybe they'll give you illegal drugs. You just don't know. The answer is going to be efavirenz, because efavivids. Now, there are three NNRTIs that you need to know: deliviridine, efavirenz, and nevirapine. And the question is, how do you memorize that these three are NNRTIs? And I told you back when we talked about NRTIs that to know the list of NRTIs, we'll use the process of elimination. So all you need to know, if you can memorize that deliviridine, efavirenz, and nevirapine are NNRTIs, then anytime you get a drug that's not these three and not the future drugs we'll talk about in the rest of this video, and those all make sense because they all sound the same, you'll know that it's an NRTI. So the process of elimination becomes a lot clearer. So really we need to memorize D, E, and N as the NNRTIs. Now, how do we do this? I kind of have a ridiculous mnemonic here, but I promise you it works. So when I was growing up, I had a dog, loved my dog. And the one thing about our dog was that he always would go into the den and try to take a poop. So a lot of the time we found ourselves saying, no, 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 not in the den. No, 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 not in the den. And that's my mnemonic here. The no, no reminds me of the two N's for the NNRTIs. No, no, not in the den. And den, D-E-N, for deliviridine, efavirenz, and nevirapine. So just think about my dog trying to poop in our den, and I would always say to him, no, no, not in the den. And no, no, NN for NNRTI, not in the den, DEN, for deliviridine, efavirenz, and nevirapine. Again, guys and girls, I know that this is a ridiculous mnemonic, but if you remember the situation, it makes it really easy to use. Because when you're on an exam, you get a question and you're not sure if the medication is an NNRTI or an NRTI, you're going to think, oh, NNRTI. No, no, not in the den. Den, is it the D drug, the E drug, or the N drug? And if it's not, then it's an NRTI. Easy, done, over, free point, bank it. So I want to slow down for just a second and show you guys where we are so far. You already fully understand the NRTIs and the NNRTIs. You've also got some just frankly gorgeous back pocket mnemonics. So you're well on your way to getting a ton of free points that those who don't watch this video won't get. Now let's talk about the protease inhibitors. So before I get into the different types of drugs and the mechanism, I think it just makes sense to clear up all of the complexity of the mechanism of the next few drugs. If we go through the like overview of how HIV works its way into the genome and then becomes the mature virus. So we've already talked about reverse transcriptase, which basically creates this double-stranded viral DNA. And then once that's created, that goes to integrase. And the integrase, as the name implies, integrates it or incorporates it into the host genome. Now, once that viral DNA is integrated into the host genome, just like any DNA, it will transcribe mRNA protein products. And as this happens, you get these protein products that get spit out. Along comes this enzyme protease, and protease's job is to cleave those immature precursor proteins into fragments, which ultimately go on to develop mature viral particles, which are then released and are the infectious viral particles that we think of when we think of the concept of HIV. So if we give somebody a protease inhibitor, just as the name suggests, we introduce this drug which acts on and inhibits protease. So effectively, we knock out protease's ability to cleave the premature viral protein products and therefore never give rise to the mature viral particles which go on to infect other cells. So protease inhibitors, if I were to summarize that whole flow into one sentence, I would say that the mechanism is that these medications block HIV-1 protease's ability to cleave protein precursors, effectively blocking viral maturation. So it's not just that you're inhibiting protease, you have to know the implication of that, which means you block viral maturation. So that's the mechanism of protease inhibitors. Let's talk about side effects. So generally speaking, hyperglycemia, GI side effects such as diarrhea, lipodystrophy, nephropathy, which is specific to indinavir. So some primary literature cites this as nephropathy. Others say nephrolithiasis. Just think nephropathy as big picture idea for this drug specifically. And then if you only see an answer choice of nephrolithiasis, you could pick that thinking that it's somewhat related. And then P450 inhibition, which is specific to ritonavir. All right. So I know you're starting to hyperventilate again because now we're talking about specific side effects to specific drugs. But don't worry, I've got some awesome mnemonics. So first of all, you need a way to remember that indinavir is nephropathy or questionably nephrolithiasis. But regardless of which one it actually is, again, this totally depends on what you read and is well beyond the scope of what you need to know for USMLE or COMLEX. You need to know that the problem is indikidney, right? So indinavir, the problem is indikidney, okay? So that's how you memorize that one. Super duper easy. But dirty, what about ritonavir? How will I ever remember P450 inhibition? Okay, so for ritonavir, you want to memorize that ritonavir or ritonavir turns on other drugs by blocking P450. Bam. Easy. So remember that when you inhibit P450, you're turning off the thing or the enzyme that normally breaks down a drug. So if you turn off the enzyme that breaks it down, that other drug won't be broken down and the concentration will go up. So ritonavir turns on other drugs by blocking P450. Now, as far as the ways to memorize the general side effects or the general adverse effects of protease inhibitors, just look at that protease inhibitors because it causes lipodystrophy, hyperglycemia, and profuse diarrhea. So instead of lipodystrophy, hyperglycemia, and GI effects, I think lipodystrophy, hyperglycemia, profuse diarrhea for protease inhibitors. Now, as far as recognition on the exam, you obviously need to know which medications are protease inhibitors. Those medications include atazanavir, indinavir, and ritonavir. So as you see, and this is not an all-inclusive list because there are many more protease inhibitors, but the bottom line is that all protease inhibitors end with navir. So any medication you see that's navir is a protease inhibitor. Now the question is how do you memorize this? Well, my mnemonic here is that protease inhibitors navir or never allow for mature viruses, which tells you two things, right? It tells you that all the medications you see that end in navir are protease inhibitors, but it also reminds you of the mechanism of protease inhibitors because the job of protease is to cleave those premature protein fragments and then allow them to go off and create those mature infectious viral particles. So protease inhibitors never or navir allow for mature viruses is the easiest way to memorize this. So here's where we are so far. We are about 60% of the way through the different classes of medications. Really, honestly, all the hard stuff is already done at this point. So you know the NRTIs, the NNRTIs, and now you know the protease inhibitors. Let's talk about the integrase inhibitors. So integrase was in my previous conversation that I had with myself because I'm a loser. No, it was in the flowchart that I went through. Remember that integrase's role is to integrate, as the name suggests, the viral double-stranded DNA into the host genome. So we give somebody an integrase inhibitor, you introduce a drug that inhibits integrase, therefore knocking out these two steps here. So it knocks off integrase, and therefore the DNA can never be incorporated into the host genome. So this is really simple, guys. Mechanism: block integrase's ability to incorporate viral DNA into the host genome. And literally the only adverse effect here that you need to know is that integrase inhibitors can increase the CK, right? They can increase the creatine kinase. How do you memorize this? What's the mnemonic? Well, I want you to think of integrase. And instead of saying integrase, you say integrase. The T becomes an up arrow. And instead of integrase, it's integrase, CK. So increase CK. Easiest way to memorize the high yield side effect of integrase inhibitors. Okay. Now here are some examples of integrase inhibitors. We've got dolutegravir, elvitegravir, and raltegravir. So as you see, all integrase inhibitors end with tegravir. And you don't even need a mnemonic here, guys, because guess what? Integrase inhibitors, it's tegra in the name. So tegravir tells you that you're talking about a tegra inhibitor or an integrase inhibitor. Bang, done. So we're cruising. I mean, we are crushing these different drug categories. You know, NRTIs, NNRTIs, protease, and integrase inhibitors. Let's wrap up this video by talking about the fusion inhibitors. Now, as far as fusion inhibitors go, my goal is to keep this conversation extremely stupid and simple. Back when you were learning pathophysiology and you were learning about HIV, you probably spent a lot of time in your classes talking about the different mechanisms of fusion, entry, and attachment. That is to say, you probably spent a great deal of time memorizing and learning about different glycoproteins and the genes that code for them. And while that is certainly an important conversation to have, when it comes to USMLE and COMLEX, particularly with the fusion inhibitors, you only need to know two drugs. One, enfuviritide, and two, maraviroc. This is not going to be an in-depth conversation about the different glycoproteins and the genes that code for them. Instead, I'm only going to tell you what you need to know to get these questions correct. Enfuviritide is a medication that binds GP41. And therefore, by binding to GP41, this medication prevents the penetration, which is to say the fusion and entry of the virus. Maraviroc, by contrast, binds to something called CCR5, and therefore by binding to CCR5, which is located on T cells and monocytes, Maraviroc prevents the attachment phase. Now it's important to point out that because CCR5 mediates the proper attachment of the virus, anybody with a homozygous CCR5 mutation has complete immunity, but those with heterozygous CCR5 mutations still get the disease, but it's a slower developing course. Now, really, when it comes to these two medications, they are sort of acting in similar mechanisms. But the big difference here is you need to know which one of these drugs, right, the one that starts with ENF or the one that starts with MA, which one binds to CCR5, and therefore, by the process of elimination, you know that the other drug will bind GP41. So the way that I think about this is CCR5 reminds me of Mazda CX-5, a very popular vehicle here in the United States. And Mazda begins with MA, just like Maraviroc begins with MA. So Maraviroc CCR5 makes me think of Mazda CX-5, and therefore I know that it's the fusion inhibitor that begins with the letter MA that binds CCR5. And then on a test, if I were to get a question, I would therefore know by the process of elimination that the other one, enfuviritide, binds GP41. So it's not going to get more in-depth than this. This is stupid and simple and all you need to know. That wraps up our conversation of all of the different HIV medications. I hope that this conversation and this video is very useful to you guys. Please drop a comment, subscribe, hit the like button, and consider clicking join to be a Dirty Medicine member.